Hey guys, in this video we will see warfarin. So let's start. It is an oral anticoagulant. Basically it's a vitamin K antagonist. Commercial preparation of warfarin is a mixture of levorotatory or S form and dextrorotatory or R form. S form is about 4 times more potent than R form. Now let's talk about its absorption and distribution. After oral administration, almost 100% of warfarin is absorbed. In circulation, more than 99% of warfarin binds with plasma proteins. This binding mainly occurs with albumin. Because of this binding, warfarin has a very low volume of distribution. Now let's go to its site of action, which is mainly liver. Here it inhibits synthesis of vitamin K dependent clotting factors. These factors are factor 2, 7, 9 and 10. To understand how exactly this is done, let's first see how they are synthesized normally. These clotting factors have glutamic acid residues. For proper functioning of clotting factor, these residues need to be carboxylated. This carboxylation is responsibility of this gamma-glutamyl carboxylase enzyme, and it also requires vitamin K. Reduced form of vitamin K serves as a cofactor in this reaction. Together, they carry out carboxylation of glutamic acid residue. In the reaction, reduced hydroquinone form of vitamin K is converted into oxidized or epoxide form. This form is not active. To reactivate it, there is an enzyme called vitamin K epoxide reductase. It reduces vitamin K back to its hydroquinone form. So vitamin K becomes active again. The clotting factor thus synthesized is released into the circulation and the cycle is repeated to synthesize more factors. Now let's see the importance of this carboxylation reaction. The carboxylation provides negative charge to the glutamic acid residues. This negative charge is essential for its binding with calcium, which associates the clotting factor to the membrane phospholipids of platelet. This allows the activation as well as subsequent participation of this clotting factor in coagulation. Thus, this carboxylation is very important for clotting factor to do its normal job. Now if you give warfarin to the patient, it will inhibit vitamin K epoxide reductase enzyme. So vitamin K is not reactivated and it stays in inactive form. Without help from vitamin K, the carboxylation of glutamic acid residues come to a halt. So now these factors are released into the circulation without the carboxyl group. Without this group, their ability to participate in coagulation is greatly reduced. So they wander in the circulation without doing their job. So coagulation is impaired. This anticoagulant effect of warfarin develops after 3 to 4 days of starting therapy. That is because although newly synthesized clotting factors are defective, the factors that were already synthesized earlier are fully functional. They stay in blood for a few days and contribute in coagulation. As these factors are degraded and defective factors replace them, the effect of warfarin appears. If we talk about individual clotting factors, factor 7 is first to disappear. Its half-life is about 6 hours, which is shortest among all. So it's first to drop. Then factor 9 with half-life of about 24 hours is second to disappear. Then goes factor 10, whose half-life is about 40 hours. Factor 2 stays the longest. Its half-life is about 60 hours. So it takes 3 to 4 days for its level to drop. Because of this, effect of warfarin starts developing from the first day, but it's completely developed only by 3 to 4 days. This is one of the reasons why we give heparin during first 5 to 7 days of warfarin therapy. Its effect starts immediately and it is given till the effect of warfarin is completely developed. Now few more points regarding mechanism. As inhibition of synthesis of clotting factors is possible only in living person, warfarin works only in vivo. It has no in vitro anticoagulant activity. Other vitamin K antagonists like acinocomerol and phenindione also work by same mechanism. So that was the mechanism of action of warfarin. Now let's see its elimination. Half-life of warfarin is about 40 hours. Its elimination occurs mainly by CYP2C9. Now one of the most discussed topic about warfarin, its interactions. We will see interactions of warfarin with drugs and diseases together. First, factors that increase the effect of warfarin. Here we have vitamin K deficiency first. It might be due to its reduced dietary intake, or due to antibiotic use which destroys the vitamin K synthesizing bacteria, or due to malabsorption from intestine. When patient is already vitamin K deficient, it becomes easy for warfarin to inhibit its activity. Next, drugs like sulphonamide, phenytoin, valproate and probenecid displace the warfarin from plasma protein. So more warfarin is present in free form to work. Next, in liver diseases, capacity to synthesize clotting factor is reduced due to disease itself. So warfarin effect is increased. Third generation cephalosporines and salicylates inhibit activation of vitamin K similar to warfarin. So effect of warfarin is potentiated. Salicylates, for example aspirin, also have antiplatelet activity. This further enhances the bleeding tendency in patients with warfarin. Next, hyperthyroidism. It is a hypermetabolic state. Clotting factors are degraded much faster in this condition, which increases warfarin effect. Finally, enzyme inhibitors like cimetidine, amiodarone, disulfiram, erythromycin and metronidazole reduce the elimination of warfarin and thus increase its effect. Similarly, elimination is reduced in patients with defect in CYP2C9 enzyme. So these were the factors that increase the warfarin effect. Now the factors that decrease the effect of warfarin. First, increased dietary intake of vitamin K. Obviously, if patient is secretly taking antidote of warfarin in diet, its effect will reduce. Second, with cholestyramine and habitual use of liquid paraffin, warfarin is lost in feces. I mean its absorption is reduced. Next, mutation in vitamin K epoxide reductase renders the enzyme incapable of binding with warfarin. So warfarin cannot inhibit this mutated enzyme. In pregnancy and patients taking estrogen-containing contraceptive pills, synthesis of clotting factors is increased. And in patients with hypothyroidism, degradation of clotting factors is reduced. In all these situations, warfarin will have to work harder to reduce the levels of clotting factors. Next, enzyme inducers like barbiturates, rifampin, griseofulvin and carbamazepine increase the metabolism of warfarin. And finally, in patients of nephrotic syndrome, protein-bound drug is lost in urine. All of them reduce the effect of warfarin. So these are the factors that affect the warfarin response. Be cautious about these conditions if your patient is taking warfarin. Now let's move to the uses. Warfarin is used in deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. As venous thrombi are rich in fibrin, anticoagulants are preferred in these conditions. It is also used in post-MI patients, unstable angina, atrial fibrillation, after cardiac valve replacement, and cerebrovascular diseases. Monitoring of warfarin therapy is done by international normalized ratio. Ideally, it should be maintained from 2 to 3. It should be maintained towards higher side like 2.5 to 3.5 in some patients with high-risk prosthetic heart valves. So these were the uses. Now let's see the adverse events. Bleeding is a very common side effect with warfarin. It may manifest as ecchymosis, epistaxis, hematuria, gastrointestinal bleeding, etc. Yeah, I know it's a simple side effect to understand based on its pharmacological action. But next one is more interesting. Skin necrosis. The mechanism behind this adverse event is a game of balance between procoagulant or clotting factors and anticoagulant factors. If you have seen video of vitamin K with full concentration, you might have noticed that vitamin K is involved in synthesis of not only clotting factors, but also in synthesis of very important anticoagulant factor, protein C. So once the warfarin inhibits vitamin K activity, levels from both the sides start to drop. However, half-life of protein C is about 8 hours. This is much shorter than half-lives of most of the vitamin K dependent clotting factors. For example, half-life of factor 2 is about 60 hours and that of factor 10 is about 40 hours. Because of shorter half-life, protein C depletes much faster than clotting factors. So at this point in time, patient have more clotting factors than anticoagulant factors in his blood. This hypercoagulable state can cause thrombosis in microvasculature, sometimes leading to skin necrosis. Such lesions are common in extremities. This usually occurs from 3 to 10 days after starting therapy. As the clotting factors also disappear, the risk is reduced. This is also a reason why we cover patients with heparin during initial days of warfarin therapy. It keeps clotting factors in check whenever anticoagulant factor is gone. One more thing, as it's a game of balance, the risk of this event is higher in patients with deficiency of protein C. So this was all about skin necrosis. Let's move to the next adverse event, purple toe syndrome. In this, bottom and sides of toe turn purple and become very painful. Next, warfarin crosses placenta and produces deleterious effects on fetus. It can cause foetal warfarin syndrome, in which fetus has bone abnormalities like nasal hypoplasia, stippled epiphysis, etc. This may be due to reduced osteocalcin, one more protein whose synthesis is dependent on vitamin K. There can also be CNS abnormalities and hemorrhagic complications in fetus. So these were the adverse events of warfarin. Now let's talk about its antidote. The overdose or excessive bleeding due to warfarin can be treated with vitamin K. It is a specific antidote to warfarin. However, synthesis of clotting factors takes its time. So response of vitamin K appears after 6 to 24 hours. If you want immediate response, you can give whole blood, plasma or concentrates of clotting factors to the patient. They will replenish the clotting factors immediately. If you have understood the treatment of overdose, let's move to the last section, contraindications of warfarin. Warfarin should not be given in pregnancy, in patients with bleeding disorder, hypertension, subacute bacterial endocarditis, peptic ulcer, bleeding piles, tuberculosis, threatened abortion, recent eye or brain surgery or lumbar puncture, and hypersensitivity to warfarin. So this was all about warfarin. It's good if you want to remember everything. But if you don't, here is a short and sweet summary. Warfarin is an oral anticoagulant. Its mechanism of action is inhibition of synthesis of vitamin K-dependent clotting factors. These factors are factor 2, 7, 9 and 10. It is done by inhibiting vitamin K epoxide reductase. There is a delay of about 3 to 4 days in response after starting the treatment. So during this, patient is covered with heparin. In pharmacokinetics, its absorption through intestine is almost 100%. It's more than 99% protein bound. And elimination occurs mainly by CYP2C9. Its response is affected by so many factors. Among factors that increase the response are vitamin K deficiency, which might be due to decreased dietary intake, antibiotic use or malabsorption, displacement of warfarin from plasma protein by sulphonamide, phenytoin, valproate, probenecid, etc., liver disease, third generation cephalosporines and salicylates, hyperthyroidism, enzyme inhibitors like cimetidine, amiodarone, disulfiram, erythromycin, metronidazole, etc., and defect in CYP2C9. Among factors that decrease the warfarin response are increased vitamin K intake in diet, cholestyramine and habitual use of liquid paraffin, mutation of vitamin K epoxide reductase, pregnancy and estrogen containing oral contraceptives, hypothyroidism, enzyme inducers like barbiturates, rifampin, graziofulvin, carbamazepine, etc., and finally nephrotic syndrome. Warfarin should be used cautiously in these situations. Now uses. Warfarin is used in pulmonary embolism, deep vein thrombosis, post-MI patients, unstable angina, atrial fibrillation, after cardiac valve replacement and cerebrovascular diseases. Monitoring of warfarin therapy is done with INR. It should be maintained from 2 to 3. Adverse events with warfarin are bleeding, skin necrosis due to transient imbalance between pro and anticoagulant factors, purple toe syndrome and foetal warfarin syndrome. Bleeding due to warfarin or its overdose can be treated by its specific antidote vitamin K. Response of vitamin K takes 6 to 24 hours to appear. Whole blood, plasma or concentrates of clotting factors show immediate response. Contraindications of warfarin are pregnancy, bleeding disorders, hypertension, subacute bacterial endocarditis, peptic ulcer, bleeding piles, tuberculosis, threatened abortion, recent eye or brain surgery, a lumbar puncture, and hypersensitivity to warfarin. That's it friends for this video. Check out more videos at our channel if you like learning this way. And don't forget to subscribe because lots more to come. Thanks for watching. See you in next video.